You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. Today's program will focus on integrated pest management. Last week we talked about insects, the various insects that feed on plant materials in your garden. There's so many to talk about. I tried to separate them into two large groups, chewing insects and sucking insects, but it gets a lot more complicated than that. But that's a nice simple way to approach it at first. So we're going to talk about that today. We're going to look at products. I've got a whole bunch of products over here. You should understand the products you're purchasing. You should know the active ingredients. You should know what they control, because one of the most common calls I get in my lab, my plant diagnostic lab, is people calling up with a product that somebody referred them or sold them at a nursery, and it doesn't control the pest that they're trying to control. So we're going to look at that. We've got a bunch of stuff to talk about. I'm going to look at some website, or a particular website that's really excellent, especially for California, from the University of California. But let's take a look at some upcoming events that you can put on your calendar and get out and enjoy our fabulous Southern California weather and learn something about plants. Let's see what we have for upcoming events. The Smart Gardening Workshop will be on Saturday, March 15th from 9:30 to 11. Give them a call at 626-821-3222 at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. This is an opportunity to learn more about gardening and learning smart gardening so you don't work too hard and you grow fabulous plant material. In addition to that, we have the Garden Pests 101 at Los Angeles County Arboretum, Saturday, March 22nd from 10 to 12. So I can't emphasize enough understanding or correctly identifying the pest that is the problem. So this is this would be a great way to learn more about the various pests that are in your garden and how to deal with them. In addition to that, we have the Garden Talk with Lily Singer. This is Saturday, March 27th, 9:30 to 12. Lily Singer is a well-known horticultural writer and has a Thursday garden series at the Arboretum as well. So you always get good information from Lily, and you'll learn something very valuable by attending her lectures. That's it for our upcoming events. Now, if you're looking for something to go out and do and learn more about plants, you can go to one of the websites for either the Huntington Botanical Gardens, the Los Angeles County Arboretum, Descanso Gardens, Rancho Santa Ana out in Claremont, the Fullerton Arboretum, the San Diego Botanical Garden. There are nurseries. The Rancho Santa Ana Botanical Garden actually has a native plant nursery in the West LA area. They hold classes teaching about native plants, how to grow them, how to select them, that kind of thing. So it's all out there. It's so easy. It's right at your fingertips, right on the internet. Take a look and get out and learn something about plants and learn how to take care of the plants in your garden. Now, one of the things I didn't show you last week that I wanted to show you real quick is this. Maybe we go to the overhead to look at this. This is a piece of bark off of a pine tree, and there's two sized holes here. Let's take a look on the overhead, and you can take a look at these holes. If we can get in a little closer. Now, you can obviously see these huge holes right along here. And I don't know if you can see on your screen these little tiny holes in here. Now, the bark is gone. The bark is actually, this is all bark, actually. I shouldn't say the bark is gone. But here we go. Now we've got this showing these little tiny holes right here. Now, these holes are exit holes for bark beetles, for pine bark beetle. There are many, many species of pine bark beetle. It's not just one beetle, it's many different ones. There's Ips is a genus of bark beetles. There's Dendroctonus is another genus. Species tend to attack a certain species of beetles attack certain species of trees. So you'll get one or two species that attack ponderosa pine, and another one will attack other types of pines, coulter pine. These are all native pines, but we grow a lot of Mediterranean pines here. We grow Aleppo pines and Pinus canariensis, the Canary Island pine, Japanese black pine. We grow a lot of pines in our ornamental gardens and our landscapes, and they're often attacked by our native bark beetles if there's a problem with them. Now, what about these big holes? Because these big holes are really a little too big to be from a beetle. It's possible, perhaps, this is actually from a beetle, but I really doubt it. First off, they're in a nice straight line. They're not scattered around. These are almost certainly caused by a woodpecker or a sapsucker. And they're looking for the larva of these little tiny beetles that are emerging here. So if you have lines of rather large holes, and usually if you look at the tree, it'll be a line, and then a couple inches down, there'll be another line. Those are almost certainly from a woodpecker or a sapsucker. Now, if you flip this over, there's another thing to see here, and I don't know how easily you can see it, but there's frass in here. That's the, when the beetles eat the wood of the tree, then they have to poop it out, and that's called frass. And you can see, I don't know how you can see it, there's actually tunneling all along on the interior here, on the interior of this piece of bark. So this is a nice little display showing you what to look for. If someone tells you you have pine bark beetle in one of your pines, then you should be seeing these exit holes, because that's what's telling you you have pine bark beetle. If it's just symptoms, if you just have a dead branch in a pine tree, that's not conclusive evidence that you have pine bark beetle. It could be something else causing a dead branch. And now if you have pine bark beetle, the bad news is there are no chemical controls for pine bark beetle. I've repeatedly seen companies that apply pesticides in landscapes selling treatments for pine bark beetle, chemical treatments for pine bark beetle. And it's not justified. It's not going to work. The only way you prevent pine bark beetle is by taking care of your pine tree properly to begin with. Pine bark beetles only attack pines that are under stress, and that stress is usually drought stress because they have not been watered properly. Or they're in a dry landscape and they're not watered at all. So large pines, especially our native pines and the Mediterranean pines we grow, only need to be watered once a month. But when they are watered, they need to be deep watered to a depth of 2 to 3 feet. That's going to take 3 to 4 inches of water. Depending on your application rate, that could take 2 hours or it could take 8 hours. You want a slow application rate. If you were applying at a half an inch an hour, then it would take 8 hours to get 4 inches. And that would be the best way to water a large pine tree in a landscape. And you'd do that once a month. Certainly with this dry winter we've had, you would do that once a month, even in the winter months, and you continue it through the spring. And if you had something like a Canary Island pine or an Aleppo pine — Canary Island pines are from the Canary Islands, Aleppo pines are native to the southern Mediterranean region all the way into Syria, and named for Aleppo, Syria. And you would water them once a month, and then once you got in the summer months, you could actually let them go dry, and you don't need to water them in the summer. You could continue to water once a month, and that would be okay. Now, the opposite of not watering enough or letting them be drought stressed is watering them too frequently and keeping the soil wet all the time, which could lead to root rot. And if they get root rot, then they're going to be stressed, and they'll be attacked by bark beetles. Bark beetles are almost always secondary. They're not the primary cause of the tree dying. What's really hurting them is their cultural care. Is they either have a disease on their root system or they're drought stressed. And so, but once you get the bark beetles in the tree, it's too late. There are no controls once they're inside the tree. None of our insecticides are going to penetrate the bark, go into the wood, and kill bark beetles. There is one product that is actually registered for pine bark beetle control, Metacystox R. It's a restricted use material, and it doesn't work anyway. So even though it's labeled for it, it really doesn't work. So if you have pine bark beetle, you're going to be cutting down that tree pretty soon. Usually the top of the tree will die, or branches will start to die. And then over maybe a year or two, the whole tree dies. Pines can go very quickly. Once they start to show damage, it's a downhill slope and it's fast. So once you see a little yellowing in the canopy or branches start to die, that's it. You're going to lose that pine almost certainly. It'd be extremely unusual for you to be able to save it somehow. And we'll talk about some of these chemicals that are inappropriately being used to treat pines for pine bark beetle when there really is no chemical control. And that's also very important in the concept of integrated pest management. But before we go on to IPM, let me just show you this. This is my mystery object today. I've had it on the show in the past. See if you can guess what this is. I'll tell you it's natural. It's a piece of wood, obviously. It's actually a piece of a branch. But why does it look like this, and what is it called? It's really interesting. If you've never seen one of these before, call up and guess what it is. We are a live broadcast, and you can call in with questions about your garden, or you can call in and try and guess what this is. A friend of mine gave this to me quite a few years ago. It's one of the fun things I have. And I'll explain what it is at some point, but give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 and take a guess what this is. This is our mystery object instead of a mystery plant. It kind of is a mystery plant because, I'm giving away too much. But give us a call if you think you know what that is. Okay, let's take a look at one other thing before we get into IPM. I've got a couple peat pots here, and they were given away to one of our producer, and he got these for free, and he asked me to comment on them. Well, peat pots are interesting. The concept behind peat pots is you grow maybe a vegetable in here. You might grow tomato seedling or pepper or whatever you want to grow in here. And once they start to get up, and then you don't need to take them out of the pot. You put the pot right in the ground and plant it directly, and then you're going to have less of a transplant shock. The peat, of course, is made out of peat moss, and that's just going to decompose in the soil. So the advantages are ease of transplanting, and that you don't end up with a plastic pot that then goes in the trash and goes into landfill. So if you're using peat pots, then you're going to reduce how much trash you generate. We should all be trying to reduce the trash load that we create. Our landfills are filling up. They're going to have to start taking train loads of trash out to the desert and filling giant holes out in the desert with trash at some point in time. So reducing your trash is good for the environment. It'll reduce our costs in the long run because we all pay for trash pickup, and the less trash they have to pick up, the less they have to charge us. And if they have to start putting it on trains and running out to the desert, that's going to cost more money than taking it up and dumping it in landfills. Now, I'm not a big fan of peat pots personally. I don't use them. I have plastic pots that I use to grow a lot of plants, but I don't throw my plastic pots out until I've used them repeatedly and they break, and then they do end up in the trash. So eventually they might end up in the trash, but I reuse my plastic pots all the time. And since I've got a lot of old plastic pots, if I want to grow something, I grow it in a plastic pot. Soil in a plastic pot doesn't dry out as quickly as soil in a peat pot. But these are nice. I don't have a problem with them, really. They're nice. I just don't use them personally. If I got them for free, then I probably would have a different attitude. And I actually have bought them in the past. I just haven't used them much. So what else do we got today? Now, we talked about insects last week, and I don't know that I brought this book, but I want to show it to you again, even if I did show it last week. This is Insects of the Los Angeles Basin by Hoag. Hoag was the entomological curator, or the curator of insects, at the Los Angeles County Museum. He has passed away. And this is one of your best books for identifying insects in Los Angeles County, whether you're a gardener or just someone who's interested in the natural world around you. This is a really nice book. Insects of the Los Angeles Basin. You can probably order this online, but you can see it's got photographs and drawings of the various insects. It talks about spiders and mites as well. It talks about their life cycle, where you're going to find them. Maybe we go to the overhead, and I'll just pick an insect in here. If you're interested in butterflies. It's going to show you a lot of our native butterflies. Can we go to the overhead and take a look straight down on the book? And a lot of you may not know the difference between a skipper and a regular butterfly. And the nice thing about this, of course, is that it'll show you both the adult and the larval stage of the insect. Many times when you find an insect, you find the larval stage. So let me see if I can hold this right so it doesn't reflect too much. This is a skipper, and here's the larva for the skipper. So if you find this, you might wonder what that is. Of course, these are butterflies, or are they actually, these are probably all butterflies. And I'm just showing you some of the butterflies. Here's the larva, the Sp14 larva. So this is a really excellent book. You can get it at the Natural History Museum if you're ever down there, or you can probably find it online. They also sell this at the Los Angeles County Arboretum in their bookstore. Now here's another book I just picked up the other day. This is Aquatic Weeds, and I have this page marked. I just want to talk about one plant that's in here. Now, a lot of you may think, oh, aquatic weeds. I don't have a pond or a stream on my property, so I'm not particularly interested in aquatic weeds. But this is aquatic and riparian weeds of the West. Riparian refers to water. So streams are riparian, ponds are riparian. And this is from the University of California Agricultural and Natural Resources Division. It's right here. You can see my finger, this their symbol right there. I got this on a little discount. I got it for $30. It's usually, I think, about $40 or $45. But I'm going to open it up to this page. And this page is on Arundodonax, which is called giant reed. Now, Arundodonax, you can see right here the plant. You can see down here a whole row of them. They grow in streams. This is not a native plant. It was introduced into Southern California and all of California probably. I think back in probably the 1920s or 30s, perhaps intentionally planted for erosion control by the Civilian Conservation Corps during the Depression. Well, it's an invasive weed, especially in water channels. So along arroyos, streams, this will grow up and become enormous, and it will just fill the entire stream bed. So they're constantly trying to eradicate this out of stream beds. It's non-native, and it pushes out the natives. There's not a lot of stuff that eats on it or uses it as a food source, insects or animals. And out in Riverside, in the Santa Ana River, it's just choking the whole river. And then in the summer, it can catch fire, and you get these fires down in the river that rage on and are very difficult to control. They create a habitat for wild pigs in the Santa Ana River. They are in and around these very large shrubs and become impossible to get at them. So that's Arundodonax. That's just one of the aquatic weeds in this book. So that's a nice book. I got this for my lab because lately we've been dealing a lot with aquatic weeds, both regulated and, of course, legal aquatic weeds. If you're not familiar with what I mean when I say regulated, let me just digress momentarily. And, my full-time position is the senior biologist plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office. And the California Department of Food and Agriculture regulates agriculture, and they regulate pests. And they rate pests, A, B, C, D, and some other ratings too, but those are the four that are important. A-rated pests are mandatory eradication in the state of California, no matter where we find them, whether the state finds them or our county ag department finds them, they're going to come in and try and eradicate them. A good example of that would be the Mediterranean fruit fly. If Mediterranean fruit fly is found anywhere in California, they come in and with various protocols try and eradicate that infestation. Now, for that particular fruit fly, they use sterile males that mate with the wild females that then cannot lay viable eggs. That works really well. You don't have to use sprays. If you've been around very long, you'll probably recall that when Jerry Brown was governor in his first term, they were doing aerial spraying with malathion to control the Mediterranean fruit fly. It worked okay, except it was a disaster for public relations. People hated these helicopters flying over their homes, spraying their houses with an insecticide. That'll never happen again in California because of that was such a disaster and because we have a better way to do it now. We have sterile males that are created by irradiating them, the brood, the larva, and then there's a way to get just the males. And they're released by the millions actually every week. There's a continuous release of sterile male Mediterranean fruit flies in Los Angeles County. They don't do it in San Diego County. There's not enough money to do it in all of Southern California, so it is done extensively in LA County. Every week, sterile males, probably at least a million, are released from airplanes flying over LA County. That means that if somebody smuggles fruit in from Hawaii or Florida or a part of the world where the Mediterranean fruit fly is established, and that fruit has larvae in it, and they eventually turn into adults, and there's wild females, then they're more likely to encounter a sterile male that once they mate, they will not mate again. They mate once in their life, and once they've mated, and it's a sterile male, then they're not going to have any viable eggs, and so you breed them out of existence. So that works really well, and sometimes you do have a very good way that doesn't require other ways to control the fruit fly. So anyway, that's an A-rated pest. A B-rated pest is one that's in limited distribution in the state, and it is but does damage to agriculture, and it's up to every county what to do about it. So in some counties, a B-rated pest is ignored. In other counties, they go out and try and eradicate it. Glassy-winged sharpshooter is widespread in Southern California. It's B-rated. But we don't go out into landscapes, into people's gardens and homes and try and spray for it because it's everywhere and that's just useless. But up in the Central Valley, up in the wine growing areas of Mendocino or you know that whole area, if it shows up there, their ag commissioners will probably go out and spray and try and eradicate it. C-rated pests are widespread in the state. They do damage to agriculture, but are not regulated. Because they are widespread and they're all over the place, the state really does no business or interest in trying to eradicate them or control them. Now it's just up to everybody who owns land to control the pests on their own property. And those C-rated pests could be like root knot nematode. It's all over the state. It's very common. The state's not going to prohibit it being coming into the state because we've already got it. There's no quarantines. D-rated pests are those pests that are actually not pests. They could be dragonflies, which are beneficial, spiders, which are beneficial, or pests that are so minor that they're barely a pest. So there are some nematodes that feed on roots, but the damage is so insignificant that they're just D-rated. So that's how the state rates the pests and basically kind of how they regulate them. A-rated pests are not allowed entry into California. B-rated pests and A-rated pests are not allowed in nursery production. And then there's one other classification, which are Q-rated pests. Q-rated pests are those pests that we know so little about, maybe they've never been described in the scientific literature. It's a wholly new species that we've discovered on plant material. And so they're treated like an A, because we just don't know what's going to happen if we don't. So when we get an insect coming in on an agricultural shipment from Hawaii or Florida, and we find an insect on it, we know very little about it. It's rated Q. That shipment's rejected. It could be confiscated and destroyed or allowed to be returned to its point of origin. Almost certainly, 99% of the time, these shipments are confiscated and destroyed. But let's talk about IPM. That's what we want to talk about today. So what is IPM? It's Integrated Pest Management. And what does that mean? When did it start? And why do we even have the term? Well, after World War II, a lot of broad-spectrum insecticides were available to farmers and growers, and they were very effective. You know, DDT, many others. And you could literally just spray on a calendar basis and get 100% control of whatever insect you were targeting. And growers would not even bother to look for the insect or look for damage or take into consideration cost. And particularly, the long-term effect of using these broad-spectrum insecticides or pesticides, and what is their fate in the environment. So DDT obviously has a very, very long residual activity. It accumulates in clays and soils, and it's a big problem. So in response to a lot of that, use of broad-spectrum insecticides through the 1950s, a lot of people started saying, well, do we need to spray? When do we need to spray? What spray should we use? And that is when integrated pest management was first developed. And there are some fundamental aspects of IPM. So now, originally it was focused on insects, but now IPM is focused on all pests. And it's used not just in agriculture, it's the concepts are used in controlling insects in your home, you know, household pests like cockroaches and mice and things like that. Now, the United States Environmental Protection Agency has a set of IPM principles. And number one is set an action threshold. Now, what is an action threshold? Well, the concept here is that you can have a few pests on your plants, and that's not a problem. Because back in the 1950s, if you went out and saw one insect, you went and got your helicopter or your plane and you sprayed your whole crop. The minute you saw your first insect, or even before you saw it, you know, on March 1st, you were going to spray. On April 1st, you were going to spray, whether you found it or not. So setting an action threshold means you measure or count the number of bugs per leaf, or somehow you have some way to count them or measure them or weigh how many are out there. And through research, you can know that if you have one insect per leaf, that's not enough to reduce your yield. If you have two, you may be close. Three, you're going to have yield reduction. So you go out in your field and you monitor your crop. That's another part of IPM, monitoring. And when you find that you have a certain number of insects or you have a certain aspect of the pest present, and that meets your action threshold, now you're going to take some action to control it. So setting your action threshold, it's usually at the point at which the pest is going to reduce yield. Now that works quite well for agriculture, but how do you use it in your home garden? Usually for ornamentals, we have very little tolerance for damage on ornamentals. Usually we don't want our leaves chewed up. We don't want our leaves twisted and curled. We don't want leaf spots all over our ornamentals. We want them to look almost perfect. And in the nursery trade, you cannot sell damaged plants. So in the nursery industry, they really have a zero tolerance for damaged plant materials, and their action threshold is when you see the very first insect. So monitor and identify pests is your second aspect of IPM, according to US EPA. And monitoring is really critical. So at least on some type of schedule, once a week, twice a week, whatever it is, you're out looking for the pests. You can do it a variety of ways. You can look at the leaves, you can look at the backs of the leaves, you can look at every other plant going down the row, and you're flipping over a certain number of leaves, and you're counting the insects you find, and then you come to some type of measurement of how much pest is out there. The other part is identification, and nothing could be more important than this. And in fact, identification in pest control is actually number one. If you do not correctly identify your pest, whatever it is, whether it's a leaf spot caused by a fungus, whether it's a virus in a tomato or a cucumber, whether it's an insect that's chewing up your tomatoes, whatever it is, you have to correctly identify that pest. And if you don't, then you don't know what to do. You don't know if what you do is effective or a waste of time or making it worse. So correct identification is your first, absolutely your first step in pest control, whether it's integrated pest management or if you just want to spray all the time, you've got to identify your pest. Otherwise, you don't know what product to use because certain products are effective on certain pests and not on others. So it's really critical that you correctly identify your pest. And we'll talk about how to do that in a minute. Prevention. Prevention is extremely important. And that's actually something you do before you even plant your vegetable garden. How do you prevent pests? Well, there's a variety of ways. One is selecting plant materials that are resistant, either to the insect you're worried about or to the disease you're talking about. When you were talking about tomatoes, and I'm really a plant pathologist, so I kind of tend towards talking about more about plant diseases than insects, although we had a whole show on insects last week. You notice your tomatoes, well, a lot of our conventional or modern tomatoes have good resistance to a variety of plant diseases like verticillium, fusarium, root knot nematode, to virus, you know, they're resistant to viruses. And if you grow those, you're much less likely to have pest problems during the growing season. Now, if you grow heirloom tomatoes, you're likely or more likely to encounter some of those pest problems, like root knot nematode. So then you need to be very, very attuned to monitoring for those pests because you know you're growing a susceptible variety. The other thing is growing plants where they thrive, where they do well. If you grow tomatoes in the shade, they're not going to do well. They are full sun plant material. You know, your vegetables are full sun material. So you really need at least 8 hours of full sun a day on your tomatoes. If six is a little iffy. Maybe you'll do okay with six, but eight is kind of a minimum, at least that's my opinion. And better is 10 or 12, and then your plants will thrive and be healthy. Keeping your plants healthy is so important to controlling pests. Then you have to look at irrigation, you have to look at fertilization, things like that. So then the fourth thing from the EPA is control. So we talked about setting an action threshold, monitoring and identifying your pests, and prevention, which really comes first, before, you know, maybe, you know, in terms of preventing weeds, is putting down mulch or cardboard and mulch. I've talked about that in the past. So you plant your tomato, and then you surround it with a big, thick layer of mulch, which will suppress the weeds. That's very good. You don't want to let weeds grow. Weeds are going to use up the water in the soil. They're going to use up the nitrogen in the soil, and they can harbor insects that feed on the tomato, and they can harbor viruses that the insects will move from the weeds into the tomato. Whether it's tomato or cucumber or beans or whatever you're growing, you want to control your weeds. So prevention, you know, is much better than coming out and trying to spray with an herbicide or getting down your hands and knees and pulling them, which is what I do quite a bit. Now, so control. Once you've monitored, identified, and set your action thresholds, you need to take some control action. So that's when it comes into products or how you're going to control it. Now, if you want to be purely organic, then you're going to select from what we call organically registered pesticides. There are pesticides that are non-toxic to mammals that are very, very limited in their activity with no residual activity. And so they've qualified to be organically registered pesticides. We're going to talk about those. I've talked about them when people have called in on the show and asked about how to control certain things. But before I start looking at all these different products and talking about them, let's talk about another website that talks about IPM, and that's Wikipedia. And they've got a series of their steps in IPM. They have acceptable pest levels. That's really your action threshold. The emphasis is on control, not eradication. And so you've got to accept a few on a few. And that's what one of the hardest things to get a grower to accept is having a few pests on a few of his plants. Because his first inclination is when he sees something on his crop, he wants to go out and spray and get a handle on it right away. Sometimes that may be justified because if you don't get on it immediately and you wait and it gets out of hand, then your controls aren't going to be that effective. For example, powdery mildew on grape. Grape growers go out and monitor for powdery mildew. When they see powdery mildew, on the first time they see it, they come out and use a control. Usually it's sulfur dust. Sulfur dust can be used in the early spring. That's usually when they're going to see the first powdery mildew symptoms on the canes or on the leaves. And so they'll come out and dust with sulfur dust. Sulfur dust is organically acceptable. You can use that in organic food production. It's natural. It's not particularly non-toxic to everything. It obviously controls a variety of pests, but it's particularly good for powdery mildew. And of course, you can get sulfur dust for roses. But you've got, and when you talk about powdery mildew, you see, you do have to get on it early. If you wait just a few weeks, then now it's spread and it's all over the place and it's caused its damage. So from Wikipedia, it's acceptable pest levels. Preventative cultural practices is number two. Selecting varieties best for local growing conditions, maintaining healthy crops. And so prevention is really important. Then monitoring, and then they say mechanical controls. They separate mechanical controls and biological controls. Actually, I don't see the point of separating that. Control is actually the fourth element. Biocontrol, of course, is not something you can usually do on your own all that much. There are a lot of there's a lot of biocontrol going on, and you can encourage it, and you can avoid disrupting it. But a lot of people think that you can order some of these parasitoid wasps, these little tiny parasitoid wasps. You can from some insectuaries. But in general, a lot of those wasps are already in the environment. They're already out there controlling the problem. What you need to do is not disrupt that biocontrol if you can avoid it. So then it goes on to Wikipedia, chemical controls. Now, in IPM, the whole point of IPM is to reduce the use of highly toxic pesticides in the environment. That's the point. So when you reach for a chemical control, when your biocontrol or mechanical control, which is just removing the pest by hand or vacuuming them up, or there's a variety of ways to do that, then you reach for a chemical control. The first ones you should reach for are what we call soft pesticides that have the least toxicity in the environment. There are some that are wholly non-toxic to mammals, and so you're going to reach for those first. You only use broad-spectrum insecticides or broad-spectrum fungicides when you're kind of forced to. If you don't use it, you're not going to get any control. Certain insects kind of push you to do that. So now we've talked about those. And let's go to a little video clip on integrated pest management basics. And I know it'll repeat some of what I've just said, but this is a nice a video off of YouTube that talks about IPM and also a few other things that you can be doing. You know, if you're a novice gardener and you're just learning, it is important, or it'll help you, to keep a log or a diary of the bugs you find in your garden and what you use to control them when you found those bugs. Because in next year, you're going to probably find the same bug right about the same time of year. These, you know, insects respond to the environment. They respond to the temperature and rainfall. All those things control when you're going to see those bugs. And from year to year, you see them pretty much in the same window. So, or the same time of year, because, you know, weather doesn't change that drastically from year to year. Although this is a very dry year, a very warm year, so it's a little unusual. Typically, you're going to see the same insects the same time of year on the same crops. And it helps if you take note of that and keep a log or a diary. Well, let's take a look at this video clip, integrated pest management basics. And then when we come back, we'll look at some pesticides and we'll talk about what you should be using in your garden.
Stink bugs. Squash bugs, cucumber beetles. Hey, if you're growing vegetables, sooner or later, you're going to have problems with pests in your garden. Hi, I'm the bug guy here for the University of Maryland Extension, and today I'm going to talk about an approach for managing the pests on our plants, which we call integrated pest management. The integrated part comes from the fact that we're going to combine many different tactics and approaches to manage these pests. Hey, we're going to use cultural controls, mechanical controls. We're going to use Mother Nature's hit squad. We call that biological control. And when we have to use pesticides, we're going to try to use the ones that are most environmentally responsible. And in this way, we can produce really healthy, safe vegetables to eat. Step number one in putting together an IPM program is to build your knowledge base. Learn about your plants. Learn about the proper culture, rates of fertilization. How are you going to make your vegetables most productive? In the case of these beans, this beautiful trellis allowed these guys to grow up and just produce bountiful fruit. The other thing to learn, of course, is the pests that are going to attack these vegetables. In the case of beans, one of the major nemesis are the Mexican bean beetles. So learn about the history of these, learn their damage characteristics, how they're going to affect the plant, and that actually learn what the various life stages of these insects look like. Here's the adult Mexican bean beetle. Once you build your knowledge base, then you're ready for step two in your IPM program. Monitoring is the second step in building an IPM program. Monitoring means the regular inspection of your vegetables, and what we're looking for are symptoms and signs of insect activity. Symptoms are things like the defoliation that Mexican bean beetles are causing. Signs are the insect itself. So right here we can see the eggs of the Mexican bean beetle. Sometimes using a hand lens can really help us see very small insects and their eggs, or even mites that are on leaves. If you monitor often and thoroughly, you can really stay on top of these pests. The third step in building an IPM program is decision making. You've gone out, you've monitored your plants, you detected your pests. Now you have to decide if and when it's time to treat. In the case of this tomato, hey, there are a few aphids on the leaf, but guess what? There are some ladybird beetles eating this thing. I'm not doing anything at all. But in the case of this squash vine, I think I see some squash vine borer in here. A single larvae could kill that vine, so I'm going to have to do something right now. Decision making, that's the third cornerstone in building an IPM program. The fourth step in building your IPM program is intervention. In this case, we're going to use a floating row cover as a preventive tactic to exclude pests. Another preventive technique we can use is the use of kaolin clay. This is applied to the leaves of plants. It makes the plants unfavorable. The bugs simply don't go there to feed. A third intervention tactic is the use of biological control. This is simply using Mother Nature's hit squad, the predators, parasites, and pathogens that naturally occur and can reduce pest populations. When we've exhausted all other tactics, we may choose to use a pesticide to help reduce these populations. What we like to use are compounds that are on EPA's reduced risk list, those that are safe to use in organic gardening. Always read your insecticide label and always be careful when you apply pesticides. The fifth and final component of an IPM program is record keeping. Record keeping is used to simply keep track of what you saw in your garden and when you saw it. This will help you be prepared next year to figure out when you need to intervene. Also keep track of how well your interventions work. In this way, you'll know if a biological control or a certain pesticide that you used actually did the job. Record keeping is the fifth and final component of a sound IPM program. So that's it, gang. Remember your five steps of your IPM program. Build your knowledge base, monitor your plants, make decisions. When you see those bad boys, smack them down, intervene, and finally, keep records of what you found. In this way, you're going to be able to produce a beautiful, bountiful, healthy crop of vegetables that are really delicious.
So, you know, he really summed that up very well. What I would add is, how do you get predators and biocontrol to work in your garden? You need to have part of your garden where you grow plants not because you're going to get yield from them, but because they attract the insects that eat other insects. And so in a lot of these organic farms that you'll see around California, they'll have a row or two or several rows of what they're growing, and then they'll have a row of plants that are there to support spiders or to support assassin bugs, or to support ladybug beetles. Not, and of course they're not using, and those rows aren't sprayed with anything because they don't want to kill the spiders. And I want to emphasize this point. All spiders are beneficial. All spiders eat other arthropods, mostly insects. So all spiders are beneficial. If you go out and kill all the spiders in your yard because you don't like spiders, then you're going to see a big problem with all the insects that they were supposed to have eaten. So you know, one of the ways to encourage biological control in your own garden is to have a part of your garden where you don't spray anything, where you're growing plants that are good harbor for beneficial insects. And there's a variety of plants that are good for that. But let's take a look now. Now it's time to look at products. Well, let's take a look at some products. Now, I've said it before, the first things I reach for when I'm trying to control common soft-bodied sucking insects, aphids, mealybugs, whitefly, not so much scale, but scale as well. Scales are more difficult to control. Is I go for a soap. Now you can use dishwashing soap, it's very effective, or you can use an insecticidal soap. Now here's one particular product. Now I want to emphasize I'm not telling you to buy this product. This is just an example. But this is safer insecticidal soap. And it is non-toxic to mammals and very effective at controlling soft-bodied sucking insects, with the exception probably of white flies and scales, which are a little more difficult because they have so much wax on them. And they have protective coatings. And so, what's the active ingredient? The active ingredient is potassium salts of fatty acids. Fatty acids are soap. So this works quite well. And this is the first thing you reach for. If you've got aphids on your roses, use this. It worked quite well. You can use this year-round. The soaps typically won't burn in the summer months, but be very careful on hot weather when you're using any product. So that's our first thing, our soaps. And I need to put things out of the way. Now, the next thing are oils. Now, the caveat with oils is that you cannot use oils when it's over 90 degrees. So oils are used in the spring. And once we get into the 90s, and we're pretty close to that actually today, which is unusual, then you can't use them. But this particular one is made with thyme oil and clove oil. This is Home and Garden Insect Spray from Greenlight. And it is a combination of thyme oil and clove oil and sesame oil. And in fact, the interesting thing is some of these oils now do not require an EPA pesticide registration because they've decided, EPA just came up with a list of active ingredients that do not need to be registered as pesticides because they are generally known to be harmless. So the oils are non-toxic to mammals. You should avoid any unnecessary contact with your skin. You certainly don't want to consume this. Probably won't hurt you, but that doesn't matter. You still don't want to do it. Some people may be allergic to something in this. You may get a slight rash. It may dry your skin, so avoid any unnecessary contact. But this is one of the oil products that you can use, and this comes ready to use with a sprayer. So this would be very good for household plants if you've got cactus that get mealybug on them, if you've got some interior plants that you use inside the house and they get mealybugs, or they get, mealybug's the most common one I see on my own house plants, but there's others. This would be excellent. You take it outside, hit it with this, do it when it's cool out, cool in the evening, cool in the early morning. I'd always avoid putting these products on when it's the heat of the day. So that's one oil product. Here's another oil product. This is from Sunspray Ultrafine. Actually, the front label's gone. This is such an old, and you notice my pots, my containers are all dirty because they're in my garage. They get all dusty. But this is year-round pesticidal oil. It is, active ingredient is paraffinic oil. It's 98.8% by weight. This is how I prefer to use an oil. I get a concentrated product and I dilute it in a hand sprayer, or a hose-in sprayer. That's my preference. The way that oils kill insects is they smother them and prevent them from breathing. Insects breathe by little holes in their bodies called book lungs, and when you cover them up with an oil, they can't breathe, and it kills them. Soaps kill insects by breaking down the wax coating on them, and they dry out. The soaps can actually integrate with the membranes of cells and disrupt the membranes, and those cells dry out. So soaps kill insects by drying them out. Oils kill insects by smothering them. You're not going to get resistance to oils and soaps. You often hear about resistance from pesticides or insecticides. You don't get that with soaps and oils because they are so broad spectrum in their way they work. If you smother something, they can't become resistant to that. So this is Sunspray Ultrafine. There's also Volk Oil. I don't have that with me today, but Volk Oil has been around for many, many decades. Excellent product. There's Neem Oil. Neem Oil has some activity against powdery mildew, so a lot of people like to use Neem Oil for their roses in the spring because it will control aphids and suppress powdery mildew at the same time. So that's just, those are three oil products. Oh, and here's one more oil product. There's so many oil products on the market now. This is All Seasons Horticultural and Dormant Oil Spray. The active ingredient is a paraffin oil, 98%. You put this is meant to be, let me show you the cover here, the front. This is meant to be hooked up to a hose and then spray it right on the plant. This also works oils also work very well on mites. So I can almost guarantee if you grow tomatoes, you're gonna get probably some spider mites on your tomatoes. I get spider mites on my tomatoes every year. You've gotta look for it, and when you see it, hit it with some oil. If it's in the summer, hit it with soap. You can also just wash it off with water, by the way. Water is actually pretty effective at some of these insect pests. A lot of aphids, if you wash aphids off your roses, it breaks their mouth parts when they get knocked off the plant, and then they're never going to feed again. So actually, in some cases, washing them off with a strong stream of water is just as effective at using oils and soaps. Remember, oils and soaps have no residual activity. They are contact insecticides. You have to spray it right on the insect for it to work. So concentrate the spray where the insect is, often on the back of the leaf. Like on mites, they're usually on the backs of the leaves, not so much on the tops of the leaves. Most insects don't like to be on the tops of the leaves. That exposes them to predators, birds, and other insects that might eat them. It's sunny and hot on the top of the leaf. It's cooler on the back of the leaf. So when you're using soaps and oils, spray the back of the leaf. Now, so those are good for the sucking insects. What about chewing insects? Well, let's talk a little bit about caterpillars and moths. You might not have thought about this. Moths are one of the major groups of agricultural pests. There are many, many moths that are devastating to various crops. Let's talk about tomato again. There's two moths that get on tomato, the tobacco hornworm and the tomato hornworm. They look very, very similar, and they both turn into a sphinx moth. Well, those hornworms can get this big. They're huge. And once they get big, they can defoliate a tomato plant. So you want to protect your tomatoes. The easiest way to do that is with Bacillus thuringiensis. Bacillus thuringiensis, often abbreviated as BT, is a bacteria that kills caterpillars. So it'll kill caterpillars for either butterflies and moths. And this is some right here. And it says safer caterpillar killer. The active ingredient is Bacillus thuringiensis at 12.7%. So you spray your plant with this probably once or twice a month, and you'll have no caterpillar problem. And I've used this on, one time I used it on petunias. There were caterpillars eating all the flowers. Well, the reason you're growing petunias is for the flowers, and so it was wrecking the flowers. So I sprayed with BT onto those petunias, and within probably 2 days, every caterpillar had died. Now they consume the bacteria, and it disrupts their gut, and it poisons them. They actually make a toxin. BT makes a toxin that kills the caterpillars. Now, I might digress again here for a moment and tell you that the genes in the bacteria that code for the toxin have been cloned and put into other crops. Those are genetically modified organisms, GMOs. So there's BT corn and BT cotton, and those plants actually make the toxin from Bacillus thuringiensis. So if you've got 100 acres of corn and the corn earworm comes in, which is a caterpillar, and it turns into a moth, then you don't have to spray, which saves you a lot of money on fuel. Now, a lot of people don't like GMOs. I think that's kind of silly. But anyway, that's the way it is. And you should probably be aware of what they're talking about when they talk about GMOs. Now, so that's BT. Now, this next product I have is also for chewing insects. This is Monterey Garden Insect Spray, and the active ingredient is spinosad. And I know you can't read it here, but right here it says spinosad, and it says a mixture of spinosyn A and spinosyn D, 0.5%, inert ingredients 99.9%. Now, spinosad is organically labeled, and so is BT, and so are the oils and soaps. These are all organic. If you want to be organic and don't want to use non-organic means of pest control, more power to you. That's what these products are for. So what does spinosad control? Spinosad controls beetles, chewing beetles, grasshoppers, caterpillars, leaf miners. So that's, you know, chewing insects are a little more difficult to control than sucking insects. Sucking insects usually don't move around very much. They sit there sucking the plant, and they just sit there, and they don't wander around. Chewing insects are chewing, and then they're moving, and they're chewing, and then they go move on and they chew some more. So they're moving around. Grasshoppers will come into a plant, chew away, fly off to the next plant, and chew away. So often when you see chewing damage, the insect's gone. So how do you protect a plant from a chewing insect? Well, spinosad works pretty good. It has about a 10-day residual activity. You do have to reapply. Usually twice a month is plenty. And there are some very specific pests that, you know, it is your number one option. Now, again, you monitor. You're using IPM. You're not going to just come out and spray this on March 1st. You're going to wait until you see the very first damage. Now, if you're not checking your plants and you go wait a whole month, you get out there and you got lots of damage because you weren't monitoring and you didn't get your application on in time. And if you have a little experience in your garden, you probably know that by March 15th or March 30th or April 15th, you're likely to see some type of, like a cucumber beetle or a flea beetle on your beans or on your cucumbers or on your tomatoes. So you know you've got to be looking for those early in the season and try and protect your plants from damage. Now, let's just see some of the next product. There's a lot of products that I'm not bringing, obviously. This is Easy Gone Multipurpose Yard and Garden Insect Killer. This is a permethrin, okay? This is another insecticide, and this is made from chrysanthemum. It is organically labeled. You can use this for organic food production. It is not wholly non-toxic. It has a toxicity. Aspirin has toxicity. Just because something is toxic at some level doesn't mean that taking a little tiny, tiny bit of it's going to hurt you. In fact, I'll talk about toxicity in a minute, but pyrethrins are made from chrysanthemum, a particular species of chrysanthemum, and they're very effective. They are another contact insecticide with really no residual. The only one we've looked at so far with residual, well, two have kind of a residual. The BT has a residual effect because it's on the leaf and the caterpillar comes and eats it. And so it's going to last for maybe a few weeks or maybe just a 2 weeks. I'm not sure. I'd have to look into that. But this is a contact material. And if you have, say you're trying to control scale insects and you're not getting good effect with oils and soaps, and you probably won't because scale insects have a coating that protects them, you would probably then use a pyrethrin with an oil or with soap. And in fact, if you use oils and soaps, if you use them together, oil and soap together, they're far more effective than they are separately. So pyrethrins. Now there's pyrethrins and permethrins. Permethrins are synthetically derived pyrethrins. To me, same thing. But some people would prefer the actual material that's derived from the chrysanthemum. So pyrethrins are very effective and used for a wide variety of insects, but they are contact. So things that fly in and then fly away, They're gone by the time you're there spraying. You need something with residual activity for a lot of the chewing insects. Now, let's take a look at probably one of the more controversial of all the insecticides out there. And this, there's a group of insecticides called neonicotinoids. And both of these have what is called imidacloprid. And imidacloprid is one of the neonicotinoids. And that's called neonicotinoid because they have the same mode of action as nicotine. They're very similar to nicotine. Nicotine used to be a very common insecticide and is no longer on the market. You can't get any nicotine-based insecticides anymore. They're all gone. They've all been pulled. So this is Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub. And if you look at the back, I'm surprised it doesn't say it on the front. Active ingredient, imidacloprid, 1.47%. So this is the homeowner packaging for imidacloprid. You mix this up in a bucket of water, and you water the plant with it. You just apply it as a root drench to the soil. The plant will take it up, and then anything that feeds on that plant for about 12 months will be controlled. And this is a tree and shrub. This is Bayer Advanced Garden All-in-One Rose and Flower Care. And this is meant for roses. So if you want to put this on in the spring, right about now, onto your roses, this will control aphids and anything else. You also flower thrips. So it has a couple things in it. This is a mixture of materials. It also has a fungicide, a triazole, a imidacloprid. And so this will also control some diseases. Now, I don't know how well it will control powdery mildew, how well it will control black spot, how well it will control maybe rust. Those are all, you know, rust diseases are very hard to control on roses. So are the black spots. There are other things you can do to try and control those diseases on roses. But primarily what this is going to do is control insects. It also is a fertilizer. It's a 9-14-9. So what they're trying to do here is sell you one product. You put it on your roses. You fertilize them. You give them a fungicide. You give them an insecticide. This is not organic. At all. Imidacloprid is not organically labeled, and it's controversial because people are blaming imidacloprid and other neonicotinoids for the colony collapse disorder in honeybees, which really isn't justified because it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. There's other things that are killing honeybees, varroa mites and viruses predominantly. Now, there's a couple of different herbicides you can use to control weeds. And let's take a look at those real quick. Now, the most common one, of course, is Roundup. And Roundup, here's a little spray bottle. It's an old one. The sprayer is broken off. And this is ready-to-use poison ivy and tough brush killer plus. And the active ingredient should be glyphosate, and it is at 1%. And triclopyr at 0.1%. So this is a combination. This product is a combination of triclopyr, which kills shrubs and trees, and glyphosate, which kills grasses and herbaceous plants. So if you want to kill poison oak, and you want one product to use on your poison oak and your invasive grass seeds, weeds, then you could use something like this. And this is an important thing to note, is that glyphosate or Roundup is very effective at controlling herbaceous weeds, but it's not very good at woody, invasive weeds. Some of the tree species that are invasive, poison oak. A lot of people have called me up at my lab and they want to know how to control poison oak. Well, if you spray it with Roundup, you're going to have to hit it several times in order to probably kill it, and you probably aren't going to kill it. So, weed be gone. Now, here's another one. This is an old one, and I could probably go into anyone's garage in Southern California and find a lot of very old products that are really old and need to go to a hazardous waste Roundup. This is Ortho Weed Be Gone for Southern Lawns. This is, I'm not even familiar with all these things. They're using the actual chemical names, which are quite complex. But this controls oxalis and a variety of of weeds you get in your lawn. This is meant to be applied to lawns. It is a broadleaf herbicide. It doesn't kill grasses. So this is something that was sold to be put on lawns to control weeds and grasses. For me, I'd kill the whole lawn and grow something besides grasses, because I don't want to mow my lawn and I don't want to water it every week or two or three times a week. This is Ortho Weed Be Gone Max. It's hard for me, you know, these, they print it in such small letters, it's hard for me to read these active ingredients sometimes. But kills weeds, not lawns. This is another one intended to be put on lawns to kill weeds in lawns. Again, I'm not a big fan of lawns to begin with. I'm not going to control weeds in my lawns. I'm going to control the whole lawn. Now, I've got another video. It talks about IPM in strawberries. And if you grow strawberries, then you probably want to watch this video. IPM in agriculture. Let's go to that video and talk a little bit, just see how this IPM plan works in strawberries, because IPM plans work best when they're focused on a single species or a single crop and the pests that get on that crop. When you start having a diverse landscape, when you've got many different plants in a landscape, it's hard to have an IPM plan that really addresses the whole landscape. You've got to focus on species and the pests that attack that species. Let's take a look at this video clip.
Production of fruits, vegetables, and nuts has risen sharply in the last decade. The demand for produce grown with fewer pesticides is also on the rise. Along with this new demand, farmers are finding that total reliance on pesticides may cause problems such as pest flareback, pesticide resistance, and groundwater contamination. An increasing number of farmers are turning to an effective approach to pest control, which helps reduce and sometimes eliminates the need for traditional chemical pesticides. It is called Integrated Pest Management, or IPM. IPM incorporates all the methods available for pest control and uses techniques that consider both short-term and long-term effects. In this video, we'll explore why IPM was developed and learn its basic strategies. We'll then see how these strategies are applied in orchards, vegetables, field crops, and strawberries. As with any successful IPM program, it is important to begin with healthy pest-tolerant varieties. Once the strawberry planting is established, it is crucial to begin monitoring for key pests such as spider mites, Liguus bugs, and flower thrips. Two spotted spider mites are found on the undersides of leaves where they feed and lay eggs. When two spotted mite populations reach damaging levels, the strawberry plant becomes stunted with reduced yields and lower quality. In controlling two spotted mites on strawberries, cultural, biological, and chemical means must be considered. Dust from surrounding roads encourages the buildup of spider mites. Therefore, water is applied to the roads to prevent dust. Predatory mites, Phytoselus persimilis, are released annually, early in the season, and monitored throughout the year. When necessary, selective miticides are used in conjunction with the predatory mites for a quicker knockdown of the pest mites. Liguus bugs damage strawberries by feeding on developing seeds, which causes misshapen fruit and reduced yields. Vacuuming techniques have shown promise in reducing populations of Liguus from strawberry fields. The Liguus vacuum is a tractor-mounted suction device which moves over the plant canopy, sucking up Liguus. It is used once or twice a week during the period when Liguus populations are the highest. With the integrated use of predatory mites, selective miticides, and vacuum machines, naturally occurring predatory insects increase to levels capable of controlling the western flower thrips. In this video, we've seen and heard how the practice of integrated pest management is employed in orchards, vegetables, field crops, and strawberries. All of these examples show how the use of the complete farm ecosystem can produce crops just as well as chemical-intensive farming. We've seen how IPM often reduces pesticide use, thereby increasing environmental and worker safety. Integrated pest management in agriculture helps farmers increase their overall pest control while sustaining their land for many generations to come.
So, you know, the very last thing, there's two things about that video I wanted to mention. One is that you have to be very careful when you use broad-spectrum insecticides for one pest that may require it, because you're very likely to kill a biocontrol agent that's controlling another pest. It happens all the time. You come in with a miticide to get the mite, and you kill all the predator mites. And suddenly, or you kill something that's controlling a different pest, and suddenly that pest explodes and becomes a big problem. The other is the dust issue. And I wondered about this for years, why dust was a problem. Well, dust is a problem because sucking insects particularly, they don't move very much. And so dust doesn't bother them. And I'll tell you why in a second. But dust really bothers predators, bugs that walk around a lot looking for something to eat, like ladybug beetles or pirate bugs or lacewings. They move around a lot, and that dust gets into the joints of their skeletons and damages their body. So if it's really dusty, it suppresses predators, which is good for the insects that they were going to eat. So it's good to wash your plants off with water periodically and not have dusty plants. Dusty plants often lead to big mite problems. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our caller. Terry calling from Pasadena. You're on the air.
Yes, I have a question about ladybugs. I wanted to know if I should buy these ladybugs that they have on in a catalog, because I heard they eat aphids, and that might help a natural way to get rid of pests.
Well, they do. Ladybug beetles are what we call generalists. They'll eat almost anything they can get their hands on, and they eat aphids. The problem with ladybug beetles is they are generalists. They don't usually focus on one insect to eat, and they have a natural behavior to disperse. So if you go get a thing of ladybug beetles and release them in your backyard, within a day or so, you'll only have a few left. They're all going to fly away. Now, if you can get them to lay eggs and you can get the larva to be active, the larva actually eat more aphids than the adults do. So the short answer is, it's probably not going to work very well, and they charge a lot of money for them. So it's not the best way to control aphids. If you can encourage ladybugs in your garden, that's great. But, you know, ladybug beetles tend to disperse. They're not targeted to one pest. They'll eat any pest. And so I don't purchase them, and I don't use them as a pest control option. I try and encourage all those types of insects in my garden by having a part of my garden that never gets sprayed, by growing some plants that will attract them. So my answer would be not to purchase those, because I just don't think they're effective. And there's other ways that are more effective, and soaps and oils will usually control your aphids better. And aphids are mostly a spring problem. They like the soft, tender new growth in the spring. By summer, all these other things that eat them, their populations have shot up, and they're usually under biocontrol by the summer months anyway. So my answer would be, no, don't bother.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Well, thank you for watching the show, and thank you for calling in. So that's generally true. A lot of people want to, you know, release a lot of these predaceous insects and think they're going to get good control. Well, probably not. Almost all the biocontrol that's been successful in controlling a pest has been parasitoid wasps. It depends. The characteristics that you need for a biocontrol program to be effective is usually the predator has to only eat the pest you're trying to get. So the first example of that was the introduction of the Vidalia beetle in the 1890s to control cottony cushiony scale on citrus. Cottony cushiony scale is native to Australia, got into California sometime prior to the 1890s, so more than 100 years ago, and was devastating citrus in California. I mean, it was really bad because there was nothing to control it. It just went wild. Vidalia beetles were brought in, released, and within probably a year had brought that pest under almost complete control. So incredibly successful. And the very first use of one insect to control another insect in agriculture, the very beginnings of biological control. Since then, there's a lot of other examples that have been very successful, but usually with parasitoid wasps that only can lay their eggs in one host. And so you introduce the wasp, and it slams that pest. So now, I love ladybug beetles. They're great, but unfortunately, they're not all that effective. So you want to encourage them in your garden by avoiding the use of broad-spectrum insecticides when it's not necessary, and really targeting the plants that you're going to spray. So what's next to talk about? Let's see. Now, I just want to talk again briefly about Bacillus thuringiensis. There are different strains of BT. There's one strain is Israelensis, and it's sold under a variety of names, Vectobat, Mosquito Dunks, Gnat Troll, Bactomos, and that strain controls mosquitoes, black gnats, and fungus gnat, so not just caterpillars. There's another strain called San Diego, and that controls some beetles. So BT actually doesn't control just caterpillars. If you get the right strain, you can also control some other insect pests on plants. Particularly, the San Diego strain controls Colorado potato beetle, which can be really devastating, elm leaf beetle, which can also be very bad on elm, and cottonwood leaf beetle. So let's see here. We talked about pyrethrins and pyrethroids, and that they are made from Chrysanthemum cinerea folio. I probably didn't pronounce that right. Pyrethrins are neurotoxins and attack the nervous systems of all insects. Most insects are highly susceptible to pyrethrins, so you can use them in very low concentrations. They are non-toxic or quite non-toxic to mammals, making them among the safest insecticides to use. They rapidly break down after application. Lace wings are naturally tolerant of pyrethroids, but parasitic wasps and predatory mites and beetles are very susceptible. A couple common names, Ambush and Pounce, are pyrethroid-based insecticides. Rotenone was a botanical insecticide. I don't have a bottle of it here. It was used as a fish poison originally, derived from a species of Lonocarpus, which is a plant, primarily for control of various leaf-feeding caterpillars and beetles, such as cabbage worms and Colorado potato beetle. It is moderately toxic to most mammals and highly toxic to fish and aquatic life. It lasts only 6 days in the environment. It is no longer, it used to be, an organically registered pesticide, and it is no longer registered for organic production since 2005 because it was linked to some human diseases. I think it was linked to Alzheimer's. Whether that's true or not, linked doesn't mean it causes it, but it was linked, and so they lost it. Now, I'll tell you a little bit more about spinosad, because that's another organically registered pesticide. It has a very interesting history. It was collected from soil. It's an actinomycete, and I'll try and pronounce this genus correctly. Saccharopolyspora spinosa is the actinomycete, which actinomycete is a soil-borne bacteria. Collected from soil in an abandoned rum distillery on a Caribbean island in 1982. Spinosad must be ingested by the insect, so spraying it on it doesn't work. It will also move through the leaf cuticle to reach leaf miners. Spinosad does not significantly affect beneficial insects, such as lacewing, ladybug beetles, pirate bugs, and predatory mites. It is toxic to bees when wet, but it's relatively safe for them once it dries. So if you're worried about bees on your plant material, you want to use this after sunset. Bees go back to their hives, honeybees, European honeybees, will not be foraging when it's dark or in the late evening. So you want to spray this in the evening, and then it'll dry overnight and you won't affect your bees. Some beneficial wasps can be hurt by spinosad. It has an oral LD50 greater than 5,000 milligrams per kilogram in rats and mice. And now I need to talk about toxicity, because if you're not familiar with toxicity, you should be. How do we measure toxicity, and what are we talking about? Well, toxicity is measured by what they call the LD or EC50. That's the rate at which 50% of the test animals will be killed. So if you give rats 1 milligram per kilogram body weight, what's it going to do to them? You do give it to 100 rats and then watch and see how many die. Well, if you gave them 1 milligram per kilogram body weight, it would do nothing to rats, because it takes 5,000 milligrams per kilogram body weight in rats and mice to kill half the rats and mice. So that's your fundamental measure of toxicity, is your LD, the lethal dose, or EC, effective concentration, at which half the test animals are killed. So anything under 50 is considered highly toxic, and it's expressed in milligrams per kilogram body weight. So this is saying that you need 5 grams per kilogram body weight, so to kill half the test animals. So that is really almost non-toxic. Anything under 50 is highly toxic. Some of the most toxic materials we've used: methyl bromide, used to fumigate soils and previously used to fumigate houses for termites, is highly toxic. It's toxic at about 5 milligrams per kilogram body weight. That's incredibly toxic. Literally, a whiff of it would be enough to kill an adult human being. It's very, very tightly regulated. It's being phased out. It's not, basically not being used anymore. They stopped using it to fumigate houses a long time ago for termites. And it's a gas. So that's just an example of something that's very toxic. Insecticides are often in the 200 to 300 to 750 milligrams per kilogram body weight. Those are moderately toxic. A lot of fungicides are often 1,500 to 2,000 or even 5,000. Those are low toxicity to almost no toxicity. Aspirin, which we take for, you know, everyone takes it for a headache at one point in their life, is around 5,000. So every chemical produced and manufactured in the whole world is rated for its toxicity using this scheme, the EC50 or the LD50. There's various ways you can express that in terms of how you ingest it. If it's ingestion or through absorption through the skin, you're going to get different measurements. So it's important, if you're purchasing products to be used around your home, that you be as educated as possible about this. And you can get what's called a Material Data Safety Sheet, an MSDS, Material Safety Data Sheet. And on that MSDS, it will say the toxicity as expressed as an LD or EC50. So if you want to know how toxic whatever you're using around your home is, get the MSDS. I run a laboratory. I have to have an MSDS sheet for every chemical in my lab, and I have to have it in a notebook, and I have to have it available to be inspected by people who regulate laboratory safety, the Cal OSHA, and the United States Occupational Safety and Hazard Administration. So if you go buy a pyrethrin and it says what it is, maybe you should go online and print out the MSDS sheet for that. Now, they're coming out with new MSDS sheets soon that are going to be written a little differently, but they're still, you want to know those, you know, what if you're using something that's highly toxic and you don't want to do that? So know what you're buying. Invariably, people call me up at my lab and they've bought a product and someone's given them a product at a nursery or at a, you know, garden center, and then they call me up and say, oh, you know, I sprayed this and it didn't do any good. And then they tell me the active ingredient, and I say, well, that active ingredient doesn't control that pest. So it's really important. Know what you're buying, know what it controls, correctly identify the pest in your garden. If you don't do that, you're going to be wasting your money, wasting your time, and perhaps exposing yourself to something that's wholly unnecessary. Now, we were talking about spinosad. It can have a 1 week residual. It all depends. It can be as, if it's warm and sunny, it may only last a day. Now there's another one. Abamectin is produced by the soil bacterium Streptomyces vermimectinus. And although highly toxic, formulations have low toxicity to mammals. Abamectin in rats is 11 milligrams per kilogram. That's incredibly toxic material. The LD for a firm is 0.011% for fire ants. Abamectin is used often in baits for ants. And abamectin is relatively non-toxic to birds, highly toxic to fish and aquatic invertebrates, subject to rapid photodegradation. And a lot of things degrade in ultraviolet light very, very rapidly. It has a strong tendency to bind to soil particles. It is therefore immobile in soil and insoluble in water. Now you think that sounds like a bad thing. It's actually a good thing because a lot of the things that have been used in agricultural production that don't bind to soil particles leach through the soil profile and into the groundwater. And that becomes a big problem. So some nematicides that were used in citrus ended up in groundwater and that became a huge, huge problem. So you don't want pesticides to migrate away from where you apply them. You want them to stay there. And so binding to the soil is actually a good thing. Some trade names for abamectins, Affirm, Agromeric, Avid, and others. This is not approved as an organic pesticide and is very expensive. Now, some of the old pesticides. I want to talk about those, but before we go to the old pesticides, let me see here. Let's go to our next video. And what did I do with my old pesticide? Okay, let's go to our next video. And this is kind of a fun video. We saw the first video. This is the same individual from the same university. And let's go to that video, our next video, which is kind of a little spoof on CSI for gardens. Let's go to this video.
From the look of these shredded leaves, it appears that something has tried to turn these cabbages into coleslaw. Hi, I'm the bug guy here for University of Maryland Extension. Insects and diseases are going to wreak havoc in your vegetable garden. Oftentimes when you arrive at the crime scene, the perpetrator's not going to be there. All you're going to have is the victim. But like a crime scene investigator, you can use the clues. These are the symptoms and signs that insects and diseases leave behind to identify the perp. Just as criminals have specific weapons of choice, insects also leave characteristic damage behind. And the damage is caused by their mouth parts. There are fundamentally two types of mouth parts. The first is called a chewing mouth part. Insects like beetles and caterpillars have chewing mouth parts and they leave behind a characteristic signature. The other type of mouth part is a beak, a sucking mouth part. As you might guess, when an aphid or a stink bug jams that into a plant, it's going to leave behind characteristic symptoms. There are five types of symptoms that insects cause when they damage plants. First, they can chew the leaves. They can also discolor the leaves. Their feeding can cause distortion. It can also cause dieback. And finally, as insects move about the world, they leave behind a variety of products. We'll look at these. These coarse holes in a squash leaf are a sure sign of an insect with chewing mouth parts. In this case, cucumber beetles fed on this leaf early in the season. It's going to wear this damage all season long. Smaller insects with chewing mouth parts cause a different kind of damage. Basically, they feed between the lines. This type of damage is called skeletonization, and it's caused by the Mexican bean beetle. Really small insect with tiny mouth parts make very small holes. Flea beetles create a type of damage called shot hole. It looks like somebody blasted this with a shotgun. This is clearly a case of double homicide, death by discoloration. You can see harlequin bugs have been feeding on this. They take their beaks, jam them in the plant, secrete proteolytic enzymes that cause these lesions. And look at these potatoes. Thousands of leaf hoppers have moved over here. They put their beaks in, they suck the juice out, and cause discoloration called hopper burn. These two plants are in real trouble right now. Another type of insect damage is dastardly distortion. As you can see, early in the season, these bean leaves were big and beautiful, but leaf hoppers have moved in. They're taking their beaks. They're damaging those tender young leaves. These leaves are looking gnarly. They're not going to be able to photosynthesize. They're not going to be productive. Leaf hoppers, distortion. Sometimes we find a victim that's been dead a while. This little squash plant died from a bacterial wilt disease that was carried by a cucumber beetle earlier in the season. Whenever we see dieback, we know the vascular system has been damaged. Usually damage to the vascular system can be lethal. As insects move their way through the world, they leave stuff behind. Hey, they're just like us. Sometimes we can use these insect products to help us detect the presence of insects or mites on our plants. When caterpillars feed, they often leave behind silk. On these cucumber leaves, we can find the telltale signs of the silk of a little leaf-tying caterpillar that's going to defoliate these things. As insects feed, let's face it, they're going to leave behind stuff, excrement. We call this frass. If we look at these stalks of corn, we can see the frass that's being excreted and forced out of these stems by European corn borers. So we know there are corn borer larvae inside these stems. Another sign that's readily apparent are the eggs of insects. Here we see the eggs of the squash bug. These little bronze bombs are going to hatch. The nymphs are going to come out and feed, but we can detect those eggs, eliminate them, and this is going to reduce our problem down the road. So if you use the five symptoms, chewing damage, discoloration, distortion, dieback, and insect products, you'll nail the perp every time. Guess what, Mr. Harlequin Bug? You've just received the death sentence.
So that was kind of a fun spoof on CSI, and it, what it really reinforces is how you're going to diagnose the damage on your plants. It's really so typical that when you go out to look at your plants, all you see is the damage, and you don't see what's causing the damage. Now, he mentioned distortion of leaves. That could be a virus. It could be an insect that causes the distortion. So it takes experience. It takes, assistance too. So you can contact your local county agricultural commissioner for assistance. You can send in insects. You can send in damaged plant material. And you can try and get people who have a lot of experience to assist you in your diagnosis. But remember, you've got to correctly identify the pest and the problem before you start doing something about it. Now, if you have experience and you know what it looks like, And you know, oh, I've seen this symptom last year. I saw it in previous years. I know what this is. I know what to do about it. So spider mites, when they feed on leaves, they leave little tiny yellow dots. On the top of the leaf, you see the little tiny yellow dots, often right along the veins of the leaves, like on tomato. Flip it over, and you see this very fine webbing. If you wait a long time, you get extensive webbing over the whole entire plant, and then it's too late, your plant's severely damaged. I mentioned imidacloprid earlier in the show, and it is highly toxic to bees. It is used in a lot of different products besides just on plants. It's used in Advantage for flea control on dogs and cats. Now, the homeowner packaging was Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub, but for if you hire someone in to treat trees and shrubs in your garden, they'll use a label called Merit. Admire is the label used in agriculture for grape, citrus, and vegetable production. So a lot of vegetables and a lot of ag production is treated with imidacloprid, usually in the spring when the plants are little, to keep the insects off when they're little tiny. If you get insects on when the plants are very small, they can do extensive damage. Once the plant gets up and sets a lot of fruit, then insects aren't such a big deal anymore. It is very effective for sucking and chewing insects. And it is, as I said, it has the same activity as nicotine. Now, the other one I wanted to mention the organophosphates. There's only a couple left on the market. This one is no longer on the market. This is diazinon. If you've been a gardener for a long time, you probably remember diazinon. Very effective at controlling ants. I used it a lot to control some mites. It's effective on mites, but diazinon is no longer on the market. It was pulled. Has a very restricted label now. You can't use it, no home use at all anymore. It used to be used in interior homes, and it used to be used on lawns, but they don't sell it anymore. This is a very old bottle. But this is what they call organophosphate. And let's see here. The malathion, diazinon, orthine, chlorpyrifos, lorsban, dursban, those are all organophosphates. Organophosphates are cholerestorase inhibitors. They inhibit cholerestorase, and that's basically a nerve toxin. And nerves stop functioning, and the insects are killed that way. But since it's an enzyme inhibitor, insects often develop resistance to these products because they'll have a different enzyme that does the same job, but just a slightly different configuration of the enzyme. And it's not affected by the pesticide. So these broad-spectrum insecticides that are are enzyme inhibitors often lead to resistance. And so, you know, in agriculture, I'd be very careful about that. Now, I don't think I brought any of the others, but there's another one, broad-spectrum insecticide called Seven, S-E-V-I-N, and that's a carbamate, and it is also a cholerestorase inhibitor, although a different chemical. So those are broad spectrum. If you get a carbamate, if you get an organophosphate, they kill anything you spray it on. They can be very disruptive to biocontrol and other things. But on some insect pests, if it's really, really bad, then you're going to be forced to, you know, to hit it with that and then try and encourage, you know, and try not to use it again. Try and come in early with a soft pesticide. Let's talk a little bit about IPM on some very specific crops. Let's talk about brown rot of peach. And let's bring up our first picture, peach brown rot. And this is kind of what I was talking about earlier, is usually IPM is focused on one crop and a suite of pests. So how do you control the pests in peaches? And here's all your list of your pests. And we don't want to put a control for this pest, which is going to disrupt control for this pest. So this particular pest is called brown rot. It is a fungal disease of peach and nectarine primarily, although it could conceivably go to plums or apricots or things like that, but it really, those aren't good hosts. And so what's the story on this? Well, this is what a peach looks like when it's infected, but how does it start? This peach, if left on the ground or if it's hanging in the tree, will turn into what we call a mummy. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is a mummy, and bring that up full screen. Now the fungus, which is in here, is Monolinia fruticola. There's another one called Monolinia laxa, but almost always you're going to really be dealing with fruticola. And it infects, and then the peach shrivels up into what we call a mummy. And then it'll stay in the tree, it'll fall on the ground. When it rains in the spring, let's take a look at our next picture, it produces these little tiny cups on the mummies, and these are called apothecia. And lining the cup, here's the cup, are microscopic sacs, like this. And inside the sacs are spores. And when the wind blows, these spores shoot out in the air and they float off in the air. Okay, and then they land on the flowers. And they infect the flowers. And they infect the fruit. Now the fruit at that point is really tiny. It's maybe the size of your fingernail. It's, you know, maybe the size of a dime. But it's already infected with the fungus. Now while it's green, you don't see the infection. You don't see anything, you just see a little tiny green peach. And it grows up and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And right around June or so, or July, right before that peach is going to ripen, it develops these little tiny brown spots on the fruit, little brown lesions that quickly enlarge, and the whole fruit then turns brown and rots. Now, when it gets on the flowers, it can destroy the flower. If we look at the next picture, brown rot gumming, bring it up full screen. This is from the University of California IPM website. And so here you see the flower that's ruined. These flowers are ruined by brown rot. And you can also take a look at our next picture, brown rot blossom blight, which is our next picture. And you can see that it also produces spores on the infected flowers, and these fly off in the air and also create infections. So how do you control this? Number one is cleanliness. You want to make sure that there's no old fruit on the ground around the tree or hanging in the tree. And this fungus can also move into the twigs and the small branches of peach trees and nectarines and infect the wood. And you'll get a gumming canker in the small wood. So you have to prune your peaches and nectarines during the winter, usually right after leaf fall, about December 15th to about February 15th. You want to prune out any infected wood. You want to keep the whole area around the tree free of weeds and no old fruit. And then if we have a dry spring, if it does not rain when the tree is flowering, you probably don't need to use any chemical control. Because this is a flower disease and you have to control it in the flower stage. Now, a lot of growers do spray their fruit with a fungicide in maybe June, May or June, to prevent any infected fruit from developing the lesions. But that's not usually all that effective. And the most effective way to control it is to prevent the flower stage. So number one, you prune out infected wood, you get rid of all the mummies, but you're still gonna have the spores in the air because it's all over the place. And so if it rains when the tree is flowering, then you can get the flowers infected. So you can spray the flowers at what they call first pink. When the flower just starts to push up and you see a little bit of pink, then you need to protect the petals from infection by the spores. And you have to use a broad-spectrum fungicide. Now for homeowners, you could use this Funginex. This is Rose Pride Funginex. This is used to control powdery mildew and rust on roses. But you could also use this. Now I'm not sure, I'd have to look at the label to see if it's labeled for fruit trees. But you could probably find a broad-spectrum fungicide that would be effective at controlling the flower stage of the infection in brown rot. Usually one or two sprays while the tree is flowering is sufficient to protect the flowers. And if you control it in the flower stage, you'll get no brown rot during the summer months. Now, we've had a very dry year. It's not likely that we're going to have a brown rot problem in Southern California. But brown rot is a big problem in areas where it rains a lot during the spring for peach growers. Now, So the integrated control is cleanliness, pruning out infected wood, spraying if it's raining while it's flowering, and for commercial growers, they actually do some additional sprays before they harvest the fruit. Most backyard growers aren't going to want to do that. Now, the other disease you get on peaches is peach leaf curl. And let's take a look at our next picture, which is peach leaf curl. Bring that up full screen. And peach leaf curl is a very interesting disease. Here in Southern California, it's just a little bit of a nuisance or kind of interesting. But it causes this blistering and this pink color in the blisters. And it's a primitive fungus called Tephrina deformans. And it, let me get to my notes on it. Well, I know enough about it, I can just talk about it. And take a look at our next picture too, bring that up as well. And this is peach leaf curl. Now, peach leaf curl is a primitive fungus, it's Tephrina deformans. And you can see what it does to the leaves. This is about the only thing you'll see from peach leaf curl in Southern California, is these blistering and the color. Now, a lot of people get curled up leaves, and if you uncurl them, you find aphids all over the inside of the leaf. Just because your leaves are curled doesn't mean you have peach leaf curl. You've got to get these blisters. That's peach leaf curl. Now, like I said, here in Southern California, even when we get it, this is about all we see. But where it rains a lot, in Northern California and in Oregon and Washington, or maybe Georgia, where you get lots of rain in the spring, this will defoliate your tree. You'll get all the leaves will get infected, and all the leaves fall off. And then if it keeps raining, the new growth gets infected and it falls off. And that's really bad for the tree. So you gotta control this. Now, so how do you control it? Well, this is one of the easiest of all the plant diseases to control, because you can spray when the tree is dormant to control this. And that is because this fungus survives on the bark of the tree in the winter in a yeast-like phase. It's pretty interesting. When there's no leaves, it becomes a yeast, or it grows like a yeast, it buds, and it's on the bark, or it can be in the buds on the small branches. And if you spray with a dormant oil and sulfur just once during the winter, you'll get nearly 100% control of peach leaf curl. If it's very wet winter and it rains a lot, you may need to spray twice. So maybe a spray in December and a spray in January, and you should get 100% control of peach leaf curl. And you can use dormant oil and sulfur, and those are organic sprays, so you can be organic and control peach leaf curl. And like I said, it's just, you know, kind of interesting here in Southern California, because we're too dry for this to be a serious disease, but you may see it on your peaches and nectarines. It rarely ever goes to plums and apricots or cherries. Now, the next disease that you might see on peaches and nectarines is powdery mildew. Let's take a look at number 8. Bring that up full screen. And this is powdery mildew. Bring that up. And you get this white, fluffy, big spot on the fruit. And it can also show you on the next picture, number 9. Now, powdery mildews are some of the more, they can be very fast to cause their problems. Let's take a look at number 9 if we have that. So how do you control powdery mildew? Well, at the first symptom of powdery mildew, you've got to take action. So here the threshold is as soon as you see it, because it spreads rapidly and it grows rapidly. And fruit like this, if you're growing this commercially, you can't sell that piece of fruit. It's ruined. So the first application is usually sulfur dust. At the first symptom or the first sign, you can use sulfur dust. Then you could use oils. You could use neem oil. There are also now organically registered fungicides that are very effective at powdery mildew. Potassium bicarbonate-based fungicides are very effective at powdery mildew. For your home production, you can also use milk and water. Now, commercial growers can't use milk and water because it's not a registered pesticide, and they are required to use registered pesticides in ag production. That's just one of the rules they have to abide by. There are also some broad-spectrum fungicides that are now general fungicides are very low toxicity anyway. They're not the problem that insecticides have been historically. There are what they call the strobilines, azoxystrobiline and some other strobilines. Strobilines are made from a fungus that colonizes wood, like old logs or trees that are died and fallen on the ground. And the fungus grows through the wood, and it produces a chemical to suppress other fungi. It's trying to hold on to that wood for itself. Well, that chemical has been just altered a little bit because it was sensitive to ultraviolet light. So they made changes in it so it would not break down in ultraviolet light, and those are the strobilines. They have about a 3-week residual activity. So in the past, some of the fungicides that were used in grape for powdery mildew on grape or powdery mildew on peaches or powdery mildew on other important crops, you had to spray about every 5 days or even every 7 days. Now with the strobilines, you spray every 21 days, but you still have to rotate your chemistry to avoid resistance. So they start with sulfur, then they might use an oil, and then they might use a strobiline. And once you get into the summer months, you might not need as many sprays or to continue. Let's take a look at the next picture, which is a powdery mildew on a nectarine. Bring that up full screen. So if you see this on your nectarine, then that's powdery mildew, and you need to spray. Now you might want to try a neem oil, or try the potassium bicarbonate, or try milk and water at anywhere from 10% milk up to 50% milk and water. And our next picture is shot hole. And shot hole starts with a little purple, you can almost see these little purple leaf spots. It expands and the center turns brown and falls out and you get holes in the leaves. It also causes these lesions on the fruit. And so shot hole typically, again, when you're pruning in the winter, you want to prune out any infected wood. Shot hole is another fungal disease caused by a fungus called Wilsonomyces carporophyllus. It is a major disease of apricots, peaches, and nectarines. You can control with fungicide in fall to control inoculum during the dormant season. The symptoms appear on buds, twigs, leaves, and fruit. The twig and the bud blight are the main symptoms on peach and nectarines. Wet years can see fruit lesions, so you typically don't see what we see here on the fruit unless it's very rainy. So what you want to do, now this fungus, this Wilsonomyces, will also infect the twigs in the woods. So when you're pruning in the winter, and we talked about pruning stone fruits before, you're really removing a lot of wood when you prune every winter to encourage new growth and better flowering and more fruit production. You want to remove any infected wood. And then usually 2 sprays during the winter with a dormant oil and sulfur, or a dormant oil and a broad-spectrum fungicide, will give you good shot hole control. So that's usually something you have to address during the winter months. And if you let it go, you're going to have a problem. Now, I want to just, because we're talking about IPM, and the University of California has one of the best IPM websites you'll ever see anywhere. Now, a lot of universities have good ones too. So UC Florida, you know, Florida universities, the Texas universities, Colorado, I've seen all very good ones. But I want to bring up full screen right now the UC IPM online website. This is a University of California integrated pest management website. I recommend this to a lot of people almost on a daily basis. So here we are at their main website. If you click on this big button here, which is agriculture, now you get a list of every crop grown in California. So it starts here with alfalfa, almond, apple, apricot. Come down here and you can find anything you're going to grow in your vegetable garden, you're going to find here. Let's just go down and take a look at peach. Here's peach right here. I'm going to click on peach. Now I get a new page that shows me general information about peaches, dormant shoot sampling, pheromone traps, early season monitoring. Come down here, it says relative impact of timing of pest applications on natural enemies. This is all general information. Diseases: armillaria root rot, bacterial canker, brown rot blossom and twig blight. We talked about brown rot. So if I click on brown rot right now, now I get a page that talks about brown rot blossom and twig blight. Symptoms and signs: here's a picture showing damage on the blossom. Mummified fruit, which I showed you earlier. That's where I got my picture. I want to, you know, these are all by Jack Kelly Clark, UC. Here's the apothecia. I showed you this as well. So comments on the disease, management, bloom sprays to reduce blossom and twig blight to help minimize loss to ripe fruit at harvest. Removal of fruit remaining on trees soon after harvest before they become mummies help prevent reinfection of blossoms the following bloom. Chemical control, and a list of the various fungicides that can be used to control brown rot. Now, so I wanted to show you this. Now over here are insects and mites. Black peach aphid, brown mite, European fruit. Now one of the biggest problems we see on peaches, and every year we're going to get this, is the, where is it? It's the oriental fruit moth. And here it is, oriental fruit moth. This is a big problem. Bring this back up. Oriental fruit moth is a big problem on peaches. It's a moth. Moths, I can't tell you enough how bad moths are on... moths are such a huge problem in agriculture. And this one is particularly bad because you can lose all your peaches to this. And so typically what you need to do is spray with BT or spinosad early in the season to prevent them from getting in. Here's the damage you see right here. Here's the little larva from the caterpillar that burrows into the fruit. It typically goes deep into the fruit and it'll be next to the pit. So there are 5 generations per year in California, so you need to protect them. And typically you've got to spray right before the eggs are going to hatch. So let's talk about that just for a minute, because we're running out of time. When you're dealing with moths and their larvae, particularly larvae that are going to go into a piece of fruit, like the oriental fruit moth on peaches and nectarines, you have to time your spray so that whatever you're spraying is there when the eggs hatch. The eggs hatch according to how warm it is. It's called degree days. Typically, you need... You know, if you have acres and acres of peaches, you don't want to spray before the eggs hatch. Way before the eggs hatch, you've wasted the spray. So for homeowners, if you only have a couple peach trees or one peach, one nectarine, like me, you probably need to spray in early March, right about now. It's been a warm year. You want to have whatever you're using, and I'm going to use BT. I could use spinosad as well. But if I spray my peach tree with spinosad or with BT, I want it there right when those eggs hatch. When the eggs hatch and the little tiny larva, that little caterpillar, starts to go into either a twig, because they can get in the twigs of the tree too, then I want them to pick up that BT and it kill them before they get in the fruit. So typically for peaches, you're going to have to spray about twice a month starting in March. The hard thing for homeowners is to use some of these tools that growers have, but degree days is a little bit, it's how warm each day is, and you can accumulate, maybe 7 or even 10 or 15 degree days per day. When you hit, a certain number of degree days, you have to spray because the eggs are going to hatch. And then you start counting, more degree days, and then you spray again. Typically though, for most homeowners, if you've had a problem with oriental fruit moth in your peaches, in your nectarines, I would spray right about now, because we've been a real warm year, and I would start spraying about every 2 weeks. And if you're using BT, that's great. You might throw in a spray of spinosad as well, and then by June you should be okay. But that's a very difficult one. So go on to this website, the UC IPM website. Read more about oriental fruit moth on peaches and nectarines, and then you'll understand it. And read more about the degree day calculator. You can use their degree day calculator. It gets a little complicated. But we've run out of time. We'll be back next week when we talk about palm trees. I want to thank the crew for all their hard work putting on the show today. And until I see you next Sunday, I want to wish you happy gardening.